Well, hello everyone. Thank you so much for having me here tonight. It's always a special pleasure to be back in beautiful Paris. So my name is Paula Kift. I am a privacy and civil liberties engineer at Palantir Technologies. And I will spend some time tonight telling you a little bit more about the history and nature of my job, privacy and civil liberties engineering. That said, the goal of this talk is not primarily to tell you what privacy and civil liberties engineering means to me. I should add the usual disclaimer that the views I present tonight do not necessarily represent the view of Palantir. But what privacy and civil liberties engineering might mean to all of you in your respective occupations. But perhaps to begin by providing you with a little background about as to what Palantir is and where my team came from. So Palantir Technologies is a software company that builds enterprise data platforms for companies to integrate, analyze, and collaborate on their data. We are a Silicon Valley company, but we like to think that we differ from a lot of other Silicon Valley companies in the fact that we do not actually collect any data, we do not store any data, we actually don't want to have any data ourselves. What we do is help organizations, and indeed some of the most critical organizations around the world, to make better use of the data to which they already lawfully have access. This is at the core of our business model. Now, as many of you may know, the name Palantir actually derives from an artifact in Lord of the Rings, where Palantir is described as a seeing stone, that which looks far away. And it is mostly remembered now from movies, scenes in the movie where the evil wizard Saruman towers over a crystal ball to keep track of the hobbits. You are familiar with this? Yeah. But if you actually dig a little bit deeper into the history of the Palantiri, that is, if you actually read the book and don't just watch the movie, you will actually find that the story says that there's nothing inherently bad about the Palantir. No, says Gandalf, the Palantir was not made by Sauron, nor by the white wizard Saruman, but there is nothing that Sauron cannot turn to evil uses. Perilous to us all are the devices of an art deeper than we possess ourselves. So what are some lessons we might learn from this? First, every technology has the potential to be abused. There's nothing that Sauron cannot turn to evil uses. Second, don't build products you don't understand yourself. Perilous or dangerous to us all are devices of an art deeper than we possess ourselves. And both of these are ideas that have deeply influenced what we build at Palantir and how we deploy it. Now, what does this mean in practice? When Palantir was founded, the United States was going through the profound national crisis that were the September 11 terrorist attacks. In response, the US Congress passed a series of laws that made it vastly easier for law enforcement and intelligence agencies to acquire personal data of citizens and foreigners alike. The theory was that finding a terrorist was like finding a needle in the haystack. And in order to find the needle, you needed to have all the hay. But what is less well advertised in the story is the fact that this theory did not actually hold up in practice. The reason why 9/11 was able to happen was not because of a lack of data, but because the agencies weren't making use of and lawfully sharing the data that they already had. Similarly, the goal of Palantir is not to help organizations collect more data, but to help them make better use of the data that they already lawfully have. The second experience that significantly influenced the philosophy underlying the company came from the founder's previous history with PayPal. So during its initial years, PayPal was significantly struggling with fraud in its online payment systems. Human analysts could not address the problem alone. So they initially decided to fully automate fraud detection instead. But interestingly, computers alone could not solve the problem either, as the attackers were always smart enough to out-savvy the machine. The solution that ultimately proved the most successful was when humans and computers worked together. More specifically, when computers facilitated, not replaced, human decision-making. Again, this idea of computers facilitating and not replacing human decision-making was to become a core tenet of the Palantir philosophy. But how do we work toward ensuring that these principles are abided by in practice? Here's where my team comes in. The goal of the privacy and civil liberties team at Palantir is to ensure that legal and ethical principles are translated into the design and everyday use of technology in practice at both a technical and organizational level. We are a group of lawyers, engineers, data scientists, and philosophers who approach the topic of privacy from an interdisciplinary perspective. Second, we are multi-stakeholder, meaning that my team is involved at every stage of the product lifecycle, working with our engineers internally, but also our customers, privacy professionals, and the civil liberties community externally to ensure that our products can meet legal and ethical expectations. Third, we are applied in the sense that we build privacy protections into our technology by design. Palantir has been working in some of the most sensitive and complicated data environments around the world for over 10 years now. We would not have been this successful had privacy not been a design consideration right from the beginning. And if you in the audience are also thinking about implementing privacy by design, this is just an overview of some of the data protection-related functionalities that we at least would recommend you take into consideration. So discovery and classification, you should be able to distinguish between different types of information, particularly the sensitivity of the information at hand. Transparency and accountability, a very important point, it should be possible to track the history of data and verify the accuracy and legitimacy of the results. This is particularly important to meet the requirement of explainability in EU data protection law. So the ability to explain to data subjects and regulators alike what type of data fed into what type of analysis or which results. This also helps to protect against bias. So at Palantir, for instance, our data is organized in pipelines, so you can carefully track how your data was transformed over time. Differentiated access, so different users will need different levels of access to data. The underlying technology should enable this. But also appropriate use. So beyond access, data should only be used for specified legitimate purposes, and there's a variety of technical and organizational means you can employ to ensure that. Retention and deletion, so data should be stored for as long as it needs to be stored, but deleted or made otherwise inaccessible beyond that. And finally, security. Obviously, it's always a good idea to encrypt your data and put in place a multi-layered approach to defend it. So perhaps to render this a bit more accessible, imagine you work for a health insurance company. You will easily want to be able to find and distinguish between sensitive health data and other types of data, data flowing through different types of jurisdictions, and keep track of different people's claims, including the ability to disambiguate between files of people who may have similar names or similar policy numbers. You will want to be able to track what types of analysis you did on the data. So for instance, you will want to be able to explain to the customer and the company why certain amounts were reimbursed to different people, but also why some people were accepted to the insurance or not. Again, this lies at the heart of algorithmic transparency and accountability, the right and ability to obtain a human explanation why certain decisions were taken that have a significant impact on a person's private life. Differentiated access, obviously not everybody at your health insurance company will need to have access to highly sensitive data. This may vary by role, position, location of the person. Hence, your IT system also needs to be able to distinguish between those. And then when it comes to particularly sensitive types of data, such as health data, you obviously also want to ensure that this data is neither mishandled or more egregiously abused. Then you will certainly have a variety of legal requirements that will require you to store data, such as medical claims, which can be up to a dispute later on. But at some point, you will also want to be able to delete the data, in which case, again, it will be crucial for you to find the correct data and delete it to whatever standard is appropriate, given the industry or the type of information at hand. Along the lines of transparency and accountability, you will want to be able to ascribe what user actions happen where in the system or a particular analysis, when it needs to be audited. And then finally, it goes without saying that the more sensitive the data type, the more care you will need to be taken that the data is stored and handled securely. But beyond providing the technology, we also help our customers implement those privacy protections in practice. Technology alone is often not the answer. More often than not, it is just as important, if not even more important, to have organizational measures in place that ensure that appropriate rules and standards are abided by. Privacy not only needs to be woven into a company's technical, but also social infrastructure. But perhaps you should take a step back. Why is privacy and civil liberties a problem for engineers to begin with? Shouldn't it be up for law and society to determine what the appropriate standards for privacy and civil liberties protection should be? So if you study the history of science, you will soon come across the term co-construction, meaning that law, society, and technology evolve together. Along the lines of a new technology is created, over time the use of that technology becomes more widespread, social norms may change, which in turn may inspire a change in the law. Take US constitutional law, for example. So there is no constitutional right to privacy in the United States exactly, but when it comes to government intrusions into the private lives of Americans, The Fourth Amendment is usually invoked, which defines the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures. Note that this right is highly physical, as it usually relates to material things. People, houses, papers, and effects. Effects essentially just meaning stuff. It goes back to a time where, in order to discover intimate details about people's lives, you had to break into their houses or ruffle through their papers. Now, this idea of invasions of privacy necessarily requiring physical intrusions of sorts naturally came under pressure with the introduction of new technologies. And one such new technology, back in the day at least, was the telephone. So in the early 20th century, the use of that technology was not yet particularly widespread, which is partly why, when the court was confronted with the question of whether tapping the wire of a phone outside of a defendant's home constituted a Fourth Amendment violation, the court reached the conclusion that no, there was no search, there was no seizure, there was no privacy violation in the traditional sense. It was only made by the use of sense of hearing only, which is not a privacy violation. So this concept of an immaterial privacy violation was just not yet that widespread, even though Justice Brandeis was already prescient enough at the time to point out that every unjustifiable intrusion into the private lives of citizens by the government should be considered a violation of the Fourth Amendment, no matter the means employed. Fast forward 40 years, and the police listening in on people's conversations in a phone booth is now deemed a Fourth Amendment violation. One who occupies a telephone booth, shuts the door behind him, and pays the toll that permits him to place a call is surely entitled to assume that the words he utters into the mouthpiece will not be broadcast to the world. To read the Constitution more narrowly is to ignore the vital role that the telephone has come to play in private communication. So here, as described earlier, we have a classic case of co-construction. A new technology is introduced, over time the use of that technology becomes more widespread, social norms evolve, and so the law responds to reflect those norms. And interestingly enough, in this particular case, the US Supreme Court actually attempted to integrate this idea of social norms into its ruling. So previously, as mentioned, whether or not the Fourth Amendment applied was primarily anchored in physical things. By contrast, the Katz decision stipulated that there should really be a two-pronged test to determine whether or not a Fourth Amendment violation was at hand. Namely, whether somebody exhibited a subjective expectation of privacy, so for instance, when you close the door when you have a phone conversation, and whether that's an expectation that society is willing to accept as reasonable. Setting aside, of course, that reasonableness can be a very difficult standard to determine, as different people might have different impressions as to what that is. So moving forward to the present. Well, it's hopefully become clear at this point how law, technology, and society interact with each other. One component that was critically missing in this analysis was you, right? All of you sitting here in the audience, by which I mean engineers. Because technologies aren't created in the void. They are created by us, and every single one of us will bring our own beliefs, assumptions, preferences, and biases into the design of those technologies. What consequences might this have in practice? Let's take Google as an example, not because I want to pick on Google, but because Google has been at the heart of a particularly interesting court decision in European data protection law. So in the early 2000s, a man in Spain went bankrupt. But then after a couple of years, he rebuilt his business and was otherwise pretty successful. But kept on facing this problem that when people Googled his names, a link would appear to a newspaper article that referenced back to his bankruptcy, which obviously wasn't great for business. And the question arises, if he had in fact managed to successfully rebuild his business, would he have to suffer forevermore because of something that happened in the past and was arguably no longer relevant? So the European Court of Justice suggested that this should not have to be the case, and ruled that data subjects should have the right to request that online search machines de-link information associated with name searches if that information is incorrect, no longer relevant, and holds no public interest. Note, of course, that this request was not for websites to delete the information, but for search machines such as Google to no longer link to it, which in jurisdictions, of course, where Google has a 95% market share, can effectively amount to people not being able to find that information anymore. Now, there are several things that are noteworthy about this case. First, Google's formal mission is to organize the world's information and make it universally accessible and useful. This is certainly a laudable goal, and me, just like many of you in the audience, benefit greatly of the services that Google provides. However, when building its search machine, the engineers at Google presumably did not expect that one of the consequences of their technology might be that people's reputation online and offline could be irredeemably tainted. So that's an important lesson right there. Whatever you build will have just as many intended as unintended consequences, and it's important in the design of new technologies to carefully think about both. The second noteworthy aspect about this judgment is that even though the ECJ defined certain parameters as to what types of information should be removed from the web, it did not specify who should do so, based on what process and how. And the situation we are facing today is that Google's engineers were put in the thankless position of having to review what information they considered incorrect, no longer relevant, and holding no public interest. So a private company essentially making important decisions as to what information we will easily be able to find online in an essentially undemocratic and unaccountable way. And again, this is not to criticize Google. It's not that they're in this position by choice, but they were in a position to decide how to implement the ruling in practice, and they chose a process which confers a significant amount of responsibility on engineers. The EU General Data Protection Regulation, which is the most significant reform of EU data protection law in over 20 years, similarly includes a right to erasure. More specifically, that under certain circumstances, data subjects should have the right to obtain from the controller the erasure of personal data concerning him or her without undue delay. But again, the EU did not specify how it expected organizations to implement the right to erasure in practice. And this can raise a very difficult question. What data should be deleted, when, by whom, and most importantly, how? Deletion is actually an interesting technical problem. It comes across the spectrum. There are different types of deletion: soft deletion, hard deletion, deletion by overriding, deletion by encrypting the data and throwing the key away. And you certainly don't want to accidentally be deleting the wrong data. So these are difficult problems that the lawmaker essentially left to engineers to solve. Now, looking ahead, why does any of this matter? Why should it matter to you? Now, we live at a time where we're not increasingly also surrounded by data, but our identities are increasingly also constituted by data. This data, more often than not, is not shared directly, but through private third-party providers. And the way those private third-party providers process our data has a fundamental impact on our private lives. But privacy is complicated. How you define it and the extent to which you prioritize it will have a significant effect on the way you design and build your products. And the law can provide you with general guidelines, but at some point you will also have to make some important decisions for yourself. And these are just some things you may want to consider as you debate those decisions. What is the context in which you're deploying a tool? What are the legal, political, and cultural factors you should be taking into consideration? Who is the target audience? Who might be affected beyond this? What are the intended consequences of the tool you're building? What might be some unintended consequences? What would be the consequences of not building it? How does this tool align with your own values, your company's values, the values of the country in which you are based? So to conclude, engineers have the power to shape how legal specifications are implemented into technology in practice. But as always, with great power comes great responsibility. At Palantir, we like to say that we have a privacy and civil liberties team, but that ultimately every engineer at Palantir should consider him or herself a privacy and civil liberties engineer. So if there's one thing that I'd like you to take away from this talk, it's that going forward, I hope that all of you will consider yourselves privacy and civil liberties engineers also.
Okay, thanks for your talk. When you go, for instance, to an airport, currently, I mean, all the people are checked, 100% of people are checked. I'm pretty sure that there might be 99.9999% of people that are, there's no issue, maybe 0.00 terrorist. There's a risk that this, the same trend for data. What I mean is that we're checking 100% of people to find out that's 0.1%, which means in a way that it's like the Fourth Amendment is kind of an oxymoron, which means that to be sure, to be safe at home, in fact, you need to be unsecure because government, for instance, agencies have access to all your data. So the question is, how do you use AI, Palantir use AI, to manage to cope with that kind of contradiction between more security and less security because you give more data?
Yeah. No, thank you for that question. That's a great question. So I think what you pointed out actually goes back to something that I raised earlier in the talk, right? This idea that in order to find the needle in the haystack, you need to have all the hay. So again, I think that most of the time, in order to identify threats that are relevant to a security issue, you don't actually need to find all the data, you need to have access to the data that is relevant. And what our software allows companies to do is focus precisely on what is relevant.
This question over there.
Hello, I'm Patrick Samama. Thank you for your speech. Palantir is a business, is a company. I knew your business about selling powerful insights. What share of the overall business of Palantir is around privacy and civil liberties? What do you sell to who? Can you disclose a little bit of information on that?
Yes, I can give you the exact number as to what share of Palantir is about privacy and civil liberties is 100%. So I think that different companies can focus on different problems. Palantir's idea was always to focus on the most complicated and most difficult problems around the world. A lot of these will raise difficult privacy and civil liberties questions, but I think our approach is not to shy away from those questions, but to do our best to contribute to solve those in a meaningful and ethical way.
Other question? Yeah, there's one here, one here. Just before, a quick question for you, Paola. So for a startup, you know, when you, I mean, you have a lot of things to do. I mean, first you have to develop your product, find, making sure that the product meets the market and so on. And then now you have also to take into consideration this privacy and data. So what is your recommendation, I mean, for a startup? You know, I mean, resources, you don't have a lot of resources. You, most of the time at the beginning, going to put all your resources in R&D, then you're going to put all your resources in sales and marketing. And maybe you're going to realize too late that you should have thought about data privacy and liberties and so on. So what's your recommendation? And if I am a startup, who should I recruit, you know, to help me on this subject?
Yeah, no, thank you. That's a wonderful question. So I think I would personally recommend to think about it from the beginning, but to not actually think about it as a burden upon business, but as an opportunity. So I work a lot on the EU data protection legal landscape. So amongst others, obviously, the EU General Data Protection Regulation, a lot of companies struggled to prepare for that law and are continuing to struggle to implement it in practice. But in fact, the way one of my colleagues told me on the client side, the way he thought about it was that actually the EU GDPR was a great opportunity to get your house in order. So it's an opportunity to review what type of data is processed where, who has access to this data, how sensitive is this data, do I need to do a data protection impact assessment. In a way, that the GDPR forces you to clean up the house, and the more organized I think you are from the beginning in terms of how you organize your data at your enterprise, the better use you will be able to make of that data, but the more you will also be able to meet the requirements of applicable law.
Okay, thank you. Question over there.
Hello. Hello. Thank you very much for coming today. It's a very topical speech. My name is Russ. I'm an American, so I'm very familiar with Palantir. One of the things, the two words that which you used interchangeably at the beginning were companies and organizations. And I think it's quite clear that Palantir doesn't only work with companies, that you also work with government organizations. And the kind of caveat for your tool is that you can also use it for evil things. And so you allow organizations to work with the data that they have. But within, for example, the US government, you have the FBI and the CIA who are responsible for domestic and international crime fighting. But then above that, you also have government organizations like the NSA who have a very open remit about what information that they're legally allowed to collect. And this is in the US, which is supposed to have like the home of the free, that you have a government organization which can collect everything. And so how is it not a slippery slope with like who within the government you would work with? And the kind of point that which I would put on that would be the ex-Keystroke and Snowden.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Like, I think the point you raised, that it's very important to think about who you work with and what missions you support. This is one aspect you have to take into consideration as a technology company. And as mentioned, my team is involved at every stage of the product lifecycle, but that also includes helping make determinations what missions most align with our company mission as well. So I would recommend to all companies to think carefully as to what organizations they should support or not, and to what extent and in what way.
Just to be clear, so you could say, I don't think it's a good idea to work with this customer?
So I have my personal view
Okay. No, but you could say that internally, and you begin to be listened if you say that at Palantir. If you say, okay, we believe that there is a risk in terms of data and so on, and so we should not work with such customer because it could put us in a difficult situation regarding data privacy. So that's a reality?
Yes.
Okay, absolutely. Interesting.
And I think we had a little joke earlier about whether or not Palantir is still a startup. It's a very big organization at this point, but it still has a startup culture that we have very... vivid arguments, and it's a big company, you know, there are 2,000 different people from all over the world. I'm German, we have a French colleague in the audience, with a diversity of viewpoints. We have very, very heated internal discussions, my team and with the company as a whole. We encourage those discussions, and we have,
Do you have a list of governments that you wouldn't work with?
No.
That's my final question.
No response. Last question.
Thank you. Thank you for the presentation. I'm Fabien Gandry. I'm the DPO of Big Datum. A simple question. Is Palantir intending to obtain any kind of certification or labelization from the European data protection authorities?
Yeah, I think that's a good question. I think we debate this question of certifications a lot. There's some information security-related certifications. Obviously, there's no GDPR certification yet, precisely because nobody really knows what the GDPR, what the regulator expects the technical implementation to look like in practice. But from the information security side, I think there are some certifications that we can show, and we are definitely also looking into whether to expand that into European certifications.
Okay, I'm taking your micro because this one does not work. Okay, Paula, thank you very much. It was very, very interesting.